episode of the Rebel Radio Podcast. Man, I've been on vacation this week, but it kind of feels like it's been long, but also went kind of quick because I feel like we just recorded my birthday episode, and here we are again recording.
Yeah, it feels like it, yeah,
the birthday adventures. You know?
Yes. It feels like it just flew by since last week.
I know. I still have three more days before I have to go back to work, but it does feel like it kind of went by kind of quick.
Time flies when you're having fun, man. You know, those vacations, they go by faster and faster.
Yeah, I got some things done. You know, I got the kids some new clothes bought, and I haven't done school supplies yet because I'll do those at my own work where I can just discounts on them. But, you know, I got some things done, and we hung out and celebrated me getting a year older, and everything. Had a good time last night, and I'm still recovering. Man, my right elbow, it hurts a little bit from bowling, you know. It's like I felt
it. Trying to get that little spin action in there.
I felt it when I woke up this morning. I'm like, oh, why is my elbow hurt? I'm like, oh, yeah, I'm too fucking old to be bowling. But I got to watch. Dude, we are in the process of our three-episode run here of, like, kid-friendly back to school session episodes. I got to watch my language a little bit. So I apologize early on there for that. These are our kid friendly episodes these next 3 weeks. And so if I do drop a bomb, I apologize. You know, I don't know how many children are listening to it other than my nephew occasionally likes to listen to the show, but we are in a kind of a mini trilogy of just a family friendly, kid friendly fun films. And next week is going to be our back to school special episode, and it'll be a fun one. And it kind of kicks off today with an animated film from Studio Ghibli. So it should be a good run of episodes here over the next 3 weeks or so. And then we'll do some fun stuff, including Matt's birthday pick. And then we'll get into the scary stuff for Halloween and Halloween horrors, where Matt makes me watch movies that want me to pee myself.
Yeah. Yes, just a little bit of pee. That's how you know it's a good movie. Yeah.
Oh, man. I can't forgive you for making me watch Hellraiser again. Still have nightmares on that one.
It is pretty graphic, man. The skin getting pulled off people, you know.
I think I have more nightmares about y'all making me watch Robin Hood Men in Tights, where the guy falls in the water in the little creek and says, I'm drowning. I'm like, what? This is that was bad.
That was bad.
But anyway, so yeah, man. But again, appreciate you fellas, you and Matt, well, you are Matt and Long and Frank, our other former co-host, and my brother John, and hanging out and doing a little birthday celebration last night. It was good times.
It was fun, man. We all had a good time. Just, you know, being dudes.
Getting the crew, crew together. And we talked a little bit. This is a very, very early tease, but we realized that in May, Rebel Radio is going to be 10 years old. And, wow. And, well, 10 years old in the podcast format. It's much older than that in the old format. But, so we did some a very, very early pre-planning for the 10th anniversary episode. That'll happen late April, early May of next year. So, but that's a huge early teaser. But we got a lot. We got to get through the rest of 2023 right now.
Yeah, we're talking about it. That.
So, yeah. I went and saw a movie last weekend, took the kids, and you already saw this movie, and you were a little unfairly harsh, I think, on it just because they changed a little bit of lore in the film. And we talked about this last night at the restaurant. And all I'm going to say is use a bitch, because it's not that big a deal. It's okay to have modern incarnations of characters and change things a little bit. And to me, and that movie is Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, Mutant Mayhem, the new animated film from Paramount Nickelodeon Studios. And Seth Rogen and his production studio, and man, this was a lot of fun. This movie, it's a blast, man. It's from start to finish. I laughed. I legitimately enjoyed the crap out of it. Minor lore changes aside, it didn't bother me. I think there's always room for different incarnations of characters, and the essence of the. I started thinking about it last night, or after we talked about it, the essence of the characters was still there, and that's what matters. I think at the end of the day, I don't think they change the essence of the characters really all that much to who, you know, what they are as far as different versions of the turtle story. And I think that's what's important. And I did think, though, you know, I started thinking, you go back and read like the early Ninja Turtle comics where they're very dark and gritty. But, man, those turtles in those books are cracking teenage jokes left and right, despite being dark and gritty. And I thought Rogan and his team pulled that part off really well. Like, they're cracking jokes. They're being funny. Yeah, it's not overly dark because it's a more modern cartoon version for kids, but that's okay. I think, and that's what I started thinking about. Seth Rogen did his homework. You can tell he's read every version of the Turtles, and I thought he did a good mix of all the different versions in it, as far as their attitudes and the way they worked and handled things. I love the nods to the original series and things like that. I think they did a really good job with it. I also had no problem with April being who she was. I've already read complainers complain about how they made April. I don't know how she's woke. I read that they made April woke. I'm like, wait, what? Just how is she woke? She's black. Who cares? You know, it's like,
yeah,
I didn't get that. I mean, she was fine. I think the voice work sold the movie for me. I mean, they use real teenagers for the voice work and they're good. All of them. They really do a good job in the film. And I think that's what made it work, man. The voice work sells the characters on screen and it was really well done. You know, and it was just a fun movie. I mean, is it better than Spider-Man? No. You know, but I still liked it a lot as far as animated film. What was the other animated film that came out this year that we talked about?
Mario.
Oh, Mario. I liked it better than the Mario Brothers movie because to me, like, I enjoyed the Mario Brothers movie for nostalgic and being a Nintendo fan and stuff like that. But the Mario Brothers movie is pretty kind of plain, you know? It's
standard. Yeah. Kind of like follows a standard format. Yeah,
it's okay. You know, it was all right. And then, like I said, Luigi becomes an afterthought for half the movie, and it's called the Super Mario Brothers movie. But, you know, but I enjoyed it. Don't get me wrong. You know, but I just I thought Mario could have been better than it was. And the kids have watched it numerous times since. And the more I watch it, I see things in it are like, okay, that, you know, could have been better. Like
doesn't hold up as much.
Yeah, like Mario's not funny. Like he's just this kind of buffoon in it in some ways. And he doesn't really get confidence till the very end. And I know that's supposed to be the point, but I'm just kind of like, I don't know. He feels like a bumbling idiot through most of the movie. And Princess Peach is like this badass, you know, and all that. And I don't know. It was okay. And, you know, the more I watch it, the more I'm like, yeah, it's, you know, it's not as good as I thought it was. You know, I can start to see the critics' points and what they said about it. No, that doesn't mean I didn't still enjoy it. Don't get me wrong. You know, I did enjoy watching Mario. But I start seeing the points, and sometimes it takes a few viewings to see the points of what critics said about it, you know, but Ninja Turtles was a blast, man. It's a lot of fun. The only other thing I watched, I'm trying to finish season two of The Bad Batch, and man, I am telling you, Matt, you've got to get on that show, man. Don't sleep on it. It's some of the best Star Wars. This last episode I watched, episode 12 of season two, man, it is, maybe one of Filoni's best he's ever written.
Okay.
It deals with, how the clones are treated in the aftermath of the war, and an evil Imperial lieutenant who basically treats them like trash. So I don't want to say, I want to say race. It's not really racism. What is that? If you're treating them, like
prejudice.
Yes.
Yeah.
Towards, they discover the armor for the new stormtrooper program that's coming, and the clones realize, oh, they're just using us, and they have to deal with this evil lieutenant. And it's just, I don't want to say too much, I don't want to spoil it, but it's just so fantastically told in the way the episode plays out. And I'm like, I was so drawn in. I was like, wow, this is animated, and Filoni is doing the Lord's work. I mean, it's, man, really well
written. Filoni, man, he does an awesome job with everything he touches.
Yeah. I mean, you watch that
story,
the final season that aired on Disney Plus of the Clone Wars. From there,
made you want more.
All through Bad Batch. Well, Bad Batch is an extension of that, and it's just so good, man. And I highly recommend getting into the Bad Batch, man. You got to get the time to start watching it. But that's about all I really watched this week, with a short week here since we just recorded on a Friday.
Nice. Yeah. I checked out Twisted Metal. I had almost forgot that it came out, and played the video games on PlayStation with my cousin.
I think I closed my Peacock right now because I wasn't using it. But I'm waiting for I'm waiting for next month. I'm going to renew it to watch the Continental.
There we go.
I mean, you got to watch the
I like it. I like Anthony Mackie. He's good in the film. I didn't realize, or in the film, in the series. Yeah. I watched the first episode, so I'm only one episode in. Neve Campbell's in it. I didn't realize Neve Campbell was in it, and she's good. I like seeing her again. You know, haven't seen her since you know, I watched Wild Things and Scream. Yeah. Wild Things. Yeah.
Yeah, when we had our Patreon going, we should have did Wild Things on Patreon.
We should have, man. That movie is just so like it's a bad, it's a good bad movie. But it's got
some great memorable scenes in it.
It does. You've got even with the ones with Kevin Bacon in it, you know, at the end.
Okay, excuse me that for 10 funny. Minutes. I'll be back. No, I'm just kidding.
Yeah, you're like, hold on. I gotta relive these scenes from Wild Things. Oh man. Like, yep, that's what the Vatican style assassin was it got him going, old Charlie. But watch Twisted Metal. There's a lot of callbacks to the game. The lady who I don't know the actress's name, she played Echo in the Hawkeye TV series on Disney Plus, and she was at Comic Palooza. She is I forget who drove the hearse. I'd have to. I only remember like Axel and Stryker and Spectre, and of course Sweet Tooth. But the driver who drove in the hearse, she's kind of like with him. And even though they don't really,
real briefly, because I know what the game is, and I think I played it once or twice.
Yeah.
How did they turn this? How did they make a plot for this? Because if I remember right, the game is just like Demolition Derby.
Yeah, that's basically all it is. So in the series, the world is like, it looks like there's some kind of apocalyptic event. And so towns trade with each other. There's like New Chicago, New Los Angeles, New San Francisco. And so he works as a courier that goes from city to city. He transfers like medicine, and he does it in exchange for payment, which is usually in form of a gift and gasoline. And everyone's got like guns mounted on their vehicle in some aspect. They all have
a Mad Max style show.
Mad Max, but with like, you know, but with Fast and the Furious, kind of like combine those two things. And throw in a very funny and charismatic Anthony Mackie. And it's entertaining. I like it.
Are they releasing an episode a week, or is it all out?
I think it's already all out. I think Peacock just released everything.
It must only be like a few episodes. And
yeah, people are already showing like 5-6 episodes in, so it's got to be all on there. But it's just at the point where they're going to encounter Sweet Tooth. I've seen some clips leak already, and Sweet Tooth looks sort of over the top, like he's going for that over the top thing, but just not quite over the top. So it'll be interesting to see how his character is kind of played out and portrayed. But Mackie, he's not based off of anybody in the games at all. Hmm. You've got a couple people in there, like.
Well, you imagine a game like that where it's mostly Demolition Derby, you had to probably create some sort of protagonist for the show.
Yeah. Like the person that was the cop that was in the cop car, he's like this police officer that runs another, like a big band of police officers, and he deals like, vigilante justice, but he's still in like uniform, even though there's like not a real law agency out there, but he just tries to, hunt down criminals on the side of the road. He don't care what the crime is. He'll kill them. They're like, oh, vandalism, you're dead. Murder, you're dead too. It's like everyone gets the same punishment. So he's nuts. It looks promising. I'm going to try and watch a few more next week and give you a rundown on those. But other than that, Quake, I saw Quake came out again. Like they just re-released Quake 2. I don't know if you ever played that on PC, but it was it's basically almost like a Doom ripoff.
It's a Doom, it's another Doom game. Yeah.
And I remember playing Quake 4 Arena. And I thought that was like really cool. I downloaded it, played it a little bit.
Well, your homework for this week is to get back on your Babylon 5 journey. It's me and Long gave you a hard time about that last night. So
yeah, I'm still stuck on. I made good progress, and then I pumped the brakes again. So I got to get back on it.
The new animated film comes out next week, and I have it on order, so I will have a report on that next week. on the animated film.
Ooh, I got to get caught up. Try and see if I can get to the end of season two at least.
That's right. So get going, or else.
Get going, or else.
Yeah, man. I'm gonna. I will. Like I said, next month when the Continental hits Peacock, I'll renew it so I can watch the Continental miniseries, and maybe I'll check out some Twisted Metal.
Yeah, man.
Just recently closed it because I wasn't using. I'm like, why am I have Peacock? I'm not even using it. I was fixing to get charged the next $5.99 or whatever, so I just canceled it for the month. But definitely we'll have to watch the John Wick spinoff when that comes. Ready to do a little news? There's not much.
I'm ready, man. Let's do the news.
Hollywood strike still going on, so it's not a lot to talk about. This news is going to literally take us 3 minutes to get through. Wonder Woman 3. Gal Gadot talking it up last week, saying she's going to develop with James Gunn, and now Warner Brothers is like, not so fast. Strangely, though, there's still no official comments from James Gunn or Peter Safran. But Warner Brothers, I guess in a PR move, they had to slow people's expectations, maybe. They just felt
okay.
They need to say, like, hey, this, don't take what she's said is true.
Don't look too far into it.
A report next week where James Gunn and Peter Safran come out and say, well, we might be talking about it. So it's kind of like a back and forth thing here. Because, I started thinking about this. It sucks that Henry never got his second Superman film. But if you're going to keep any characters for the new DCU to go with the new Superman, she makes the most sense, I think.
Yeah.
Because she had the most widely successful film and arguably one of the best of the DC films in the first one. People love her in the role. She loves playing the role. Just the things she's done for little girls across the world and inspiration for them. It just feels like she's earned it. And I hope that they're able to work it out somewhere. She's able to come back. So we'll see. This is how slow the news is that I put this on the news. For you people that still watch movies on cable television, and there's still a few of you out there, if you haven't seen Matt Reeves' The Batman, you will be able to this October. It's going to premiere on TNT.
Really?
So, yes. That's for these people out there that still don't have HBO Max, Netflix. They watch old school cable television, which means they're probably not fucking listening to a podcast, but you never know.
You never know, man.
So if you still are an old school TV watcher, TNT still premieres blockbuster films, and The Batman will be available to watch in a couple months. It's all DC news today. That's it, man. David Ayer has been on Twitter a lot this week because a picture of Jared Leto as the Joker popped up and claiming that it was from his cut that was never seen. And Ayer confirmed it was, but that it wasn't a new image. The image had already been released. And he kind of said he did have a conversation with James Gunn. And James Gunn told him, hey, your cut's going to have its time. We're going to come around to it. But right now, let's get the DCU started. So I don't know how you take that. Maybe Gunn is aware. But yeah, he wants to get the DCU going first. And maybe we'll finally get the Ayer cut of Suicide Squad in a couple of years. And I hope it's good when it does come out, because Ayer has really played it up with his talk and stuff about how much better his cut is. So we will see if that's actually true or not when it arrives. So we'll find out. Because if anything, David Ayer's Suicide Squad, I did enjoy Harley and some of the other performances in it. So
yeah, it has some good performances, just kind of a little bit of a mess.
Yeah. Well, they cut it and they turned it into a fast-paced action film, where Ayer said there's a lot more character stuff with the Joker, and the Joker is more fleshed out. Because that was my biggest thing with it, was like, you watch The Dark Knight, and you within an hour of the film, Heath Ledger's Joker is a fleshed-out diabolical villain. You may not understand his methods, but you know that, or Jared Leto's Joker is just like this gangster with no background, there's no...
Yeah, it just kind of pops in and out, you know?
Apparently a lot of that stuff was in the Ayer cut, so we'll see. And Jared Leto was talking about it too, how he filmed a lot more scenes of the Joker. So we'll find out. But that's it for the news. So on to today's featured film. The first, like I said earlier, our three animated films are, it's August. So lots of kids are going back to school across the country and the world. And, a lot of kids in our area are already going back. Our kids don't go back for a couple more weeks because the district.
Yeah. couple more weeks.
So we're doing some fun kid-friendly films, and we're going to kick that off this week with a film from Hiro. I always say his name wrong. I got to get this right. I can't fuck up. There I did. I dropped another F-bomb. Forgive me there, children that are listening. Don't repeat the bad words that Uncle Mark says on the podcast.
Yeah, this is what not to do.
Yes, this is what not to do. Hayao Miyazaki. And, you know, master filmmaker. You know, we've covered Spirited Away and Princess Mononoke. And there's so many other of his films that he can we could choose. And we chose this one because this was his follow-up to Spirited Away, which was a big film for him. And the expectations were high for this film. And he chose to, instead of doing an original script, he chose to adapt a screenplay and base it on a book. And that is Howl's Moving Castle. As with a lot of Miyazaki films, it's difficult to summarize or describe the film. But basically, Howl is a wizard that is kind of just doing his thing, you know, doing wizard stuff. And he comes across a girl, Sophie, that he saves from some overzealous soldiers that want to indulge in their business with her. That's a nice way of saying it. And he saves her and ends up bringing her eventually onto his moving castle. In the meantime, they're caught up in a war between what is the war? It's a little confusing. There's like two warring factions.
Yeah. Two warring factions. Yeah. And you see this a lot in Miyazaki films.
Yes.
You know,
and
his depictions of war.
And Howl is kind of caught up like both sides. I kind of watched this the other. I've seen it before. I watched it the other day and I kept leaving the room. Is Howl's kind of caught up between both sides. They both want his services.
Yeah.
But Howl's not having anything of it. He just wants to do his own thing.
He wants to stay Switzerland, man. He wants to be neutral.
Right. And he kind of gets caught up on the one side because he's kind of forced to. And so, because another witch casts a spell on Sophie that turns her basically old. And she starts kind of aging backwards throughout the film and becoming back her regular self. Or so you think. That she's de-aging backwards, but it turns out that she's actually falling in love with Howl, and her love for Howl is having her turn her own curse. And then there's some great voice work in this from Christian Bell, who plays Howl. Billy Crystal, always wonderful to hear him, plays the fire monster thing that keeps Howl's castle running, you know, and
yep. Calcifer. Yep.
So as the film progresses, Howl's castle is kind of starts getting destroyed through the war because they get caught up in the war and the battles and stuff like that. And Howl's powers are somewhat fading on his own. He's trying to keep things together himself, but he's stretching himself too far. And until Sophie realizes it, that it's her love for him that's going to keep him alive, and that his heart is basically shrinking because he's used all his powers. So Sophie's love has to help him find a new heart. And that's what happens at the end of the film. She recovers his heart and gives him her love to him. And it brings Howl back to life. And he never really dies, but he's fading, you know. They basically have their happy ever after. And I'd probably summarize that in a brief of a nutshell. But there's so much happening in this film that it's kind of, you have to see it to pick it all
there's
up.
There's a lot.
But it's basically, that's what it is. A love story between two people.
In the book, Sophie, you know, because she says, you know, Howl's heart will beat for 1,000 years and it will work. So in the book, Sophie's power is whatever she speaks, it comes to be. So when, you know, she says things about herself, like I'm just an old, you know, worthless woman. And she appears more older and she gets more achy. She says things to the hats, and the hats have an effect on the people that wear them. Like her mother-in-law, she speaks to her hat and says that, or not mother-in-law, stepmother, speaks to her hat and says that you'll need to marry money. What happens later in the movie? Her stepmother marries money. And her sister, one of her sisters is an apprentice at a bakery shop. Her other sister in the book is actually a went to go learn under a spellcaster, which is why when she first turns old, she says, I need to go find my sister, when she actually goes and finds, you know, Howl's castle. But that's pretty interesting. Whenever you realize what Sophie's power is in the book, it gives you a different outlook on Sophie. So Sophie's had magic this whole time. She's the one keeping herself old, because she speaks down to herself and turns that spell that was put on her. Mm-hmm. She enhances it in that aspect.
And they allude to that in the film as she starts slowly believing in Howl and believing in the magic and stuff. And she starts de-aging and falling in love with him. So they never say she has powers, but they allude to that in a way.
They do. You know, if you're watching the film, like, because whenever I watched it for the first time and I didn't know, you know, what Sophie's character was in the book and how she was portrayed there, I was just like, okay, this is weird. I don't get how this, you know, spell works. Is Howl, you know, going to break the spell? You know, I know she can't talk about it, but like, what's going on here? Because, you know, why is she going, you know, back and forth through her aging process? And I think, you know, whenever you find that out about Sophie, you look at the story a little bit different. You look at her journey a little bit different. Mm. You know, this is an interesting film. You know, Miyazaki, I think he was approached by Weinstein to, you know, have a bigger release in the States. Mm-hmm. And he didn't like Weinstein, and you know, he acted like he didn't care, you know, how much money it made in the States anyways, even though it still did pretty good.
Right.
Especially when you got, you know, Christian Bale and a couple of Hunger Games actors, and Billy Crystal, you know, on board too. But it's, you know, I recently watched this film, you know, this year. This is like the first time I've seen Howl's Moving Castle. Mm-hmm. Earlier this year, and then a rewatch for the show, and it's got to be my favorite Miyazaki film. I think
I still lean towards Spirited Away.
Yeah,
yeah,
Spirited Away is good too. That's the one that won the Academy Award.
Yeah, Spirited Away is always my favorite. But one thing I do like about this is the buildup of this film. You know, it starts out, it's like Spirited Away throws you right into things right away as she discovers the spirit house and all that. And it just unfolds into a wonderful, magical film, where this film takes a little bit longer to build. But then when you get to those moments, the payoff of this film is extraordinary. When you realize the whole time it's a love story, and you realize that Sophie has been doing this all for Howl, and she didn't even realize it and that's what unconditional love is. So she just started realizing that she loved this guy or this wizard. And the ending is absolutely beautiful, where she sees Howl's childhood and how he turned into a wizard and all that. She sees all that.
Calcifer is able to take her through Howl's journey.
And I thought that
was how he became.
Yeah. And it parallels her own journey, you know, throughout what she was doing this time to save herself. And she sees how Howl became this and changed his childhood forever, you know, and the film unfolds, like you said, it's based on a book, and the movie unfolds like a good book. You know, it just tells the story that it's like it unwraps layers throughout the film, and the layers all pay off at the end as they are able to go off together. It's, you know, a lot of his films are like that, like Spirited Away. You know, you think about most of his majorly well done films are journey films. You know, Spirited Away was a journey of the little girl. Princess Mononoke is the journey of the warrior.
Yes.
And now they don't always end happy, because he dies at the end of Princess Mononoke, right? Yeah.
Yeah, he does.
His journey doesn't end well, but her journey ends well in Spirited Away, and their journey in Sophie and Howl ends very well for them.
And it always ends different with Miyazaki film. Usually the two main characters, you know, whether if they're, you know, opposite sex, it's like they don't always end up as, like, you know, lovers, mm-hmm. you know, or, you know, finding true love with each other. It's not how it always ends up, but this film ends up that way, mm-hmm. and it works.
And the crazy thing is, his movies are, every time I watch them, they're just like, you think that he's going to go one direction and be a kind of a standard animated film. And not that his movies get weird or get complex, but he just is amazing at throwing things at you that you don't expect, and they're full of wonder. If that makes sense. I mean, Like, you know, when Spirited Away starts out, she sees her parents turning into pigs, and you're just like, what is going on here? But then you're at the point of the story. And same like this, when she first goes into Howl's Castle, you're meeting all these different characters are in there, and the Scarecrow and the fire and everything. And it throws you into this just amazing place. You're like, wait, what is going on here? And but Miyazaki does such a good job of bringing it all together and just wonderful storytelling. And that's the magic that he instills. And for me, being older, and most of these films we discovered when we were older, because Miyazaki got his start in the late 70s and 80s, and a lot of his films didn't find American audiences till the 90s and 2000s. This must have been what it was like for our parents discovering Disney films in the 50s and 60s. You know, imagine sitting in the theater for the first time and watching Snow White or Bambi or any of those unfold on the screen for you. And then the sense of discovery and magic that Disney instilled in his films. And it was hard for us to understand that because we saw most of those movies when we were already older. But we've been able to appreciate and enjoy Miyazaki's journeys a little bit more because we've grown up with his films like our parents did with Disney films, if that's fair to say. And I hold his films in very high regard for that reason, because I think he does some amazing work. And, you know, he just released his final film in Japan, and, you know, they released it with very little fanfare, no hardly any promotion, but it was number one at the box office in Japan the first weekend.
And, wow. I don't doubt it.
No news on American release yet, but we know it's coming, you know.
Yeah, what's unique about his films, I feel like, is that he has a very unique view on war. Obviously, he doesn't like it. You know, right. He, you know, had to flee multiple towns with his father in World War II. And he even has a memory of leaving a woman and her child trying to hop in the same vehicle that they were in, but they had to leave her behind. And, you know, of course, his father owned the aviation company that built planes for the war. So he loves planes. He loves flight. He even loves warplanes. He just doesn't like, you know, what war brings.
Right.
So he has a very, very unique, you know, stance on it that you see in the films that you're able to see. And there's always really, really cool flight scenes. I mean, when Hal takes off after, you know, they encounter the wizard Solomon's kind of, you know, sorceress that wants, you know, Hal to come back, but, you know, he's going to send Sophie, you know, and say that, you know, she's his mom, or, and that he, you know, my mom says I can't come out and play or, you know, basically, and Hal, you know, pops up and saves her and gets her out of there. You know, and then, you know, him turning into the crow, is pretty cool. Very cool visually, because, you know, the crow is synonymous with like horror and kind of dark. Some people argue that he's maybe a Japanese beast. There's a Japanese beast in folklore, that it's, I can't pronounce the name, but its downfall, its weakness is overconfidence, which is, you know, Howl's downfall. So a lot of people, in Japanese culture feel like he's, you know, more closely related to that than a raven. But very cool flight from him. And, he definitely stretches himself thin, and he's very, very, very confident. Doesn't always work out in his, the way he wants it to, but he's very, very talented, hell of a flyer. And he's got a big heart. And he didn't always fill it with the right things, which is, was the downfall of the Witch of the West. Mm-hmm. Which her character is very, very odd. She's always just kind of, when she's trying to climb up the stairs, and she's just kind of like failing. And then she gets all like droopy after the, after her encounter with, this, King Solomon's priestess or sorceress. She just takes the magic out of her, and she just starts aging like crazy. Man, just a lot of really interesting characters, and the food, you know, the food's, I feel like, is animated like a Ben and Jerry's cartoon, you know, that steak that you'd always see in a Ben and Jerry's cartoon, yeah. Big old hunk of meat. That's how the bacon looks like. And I'm like, man, I've never seen bacon like that. It's like they just freaking lopped off one side of the pig and threw it on a skillet. It's huge. It's massive. But it's, you know, it's synonymous with a lot of, Spirited Away's animation for sure. I don't know about, you know, Castle in the Sky, or maybe Kiki's Delivery Service. I think the animation is a little bit different in those films.
Well, it's still hand drawn. It's just they use like Miyazaki is very, you know, he's very old school. They don't use hardly any CGI in any of his films, but they do. They have modernized as far as coloring. They do use digital coloring and stuff, and I think that's why the newer films are a little more vibrant. Might be
yeah.
a good way to see it. Where if you watch Kiki's Delivery Service or My Neighbor Totoro, they're a little bit older, and they looks more hand drawn. You know, as far as coloring, so it's fair to say. But I mean, that's the remarkable thing though is about the fact that they still do hand drawn animation. He would never give in to the CGI. You know.
He still doesn't to this day, huh?
He just, he believes in that hand-drawn style. I mean, he believes it's an art form. And I think, I can't imagine his films in CGI. It's something about the art, the animation, and the colors, and the way it unfolds. It tells the story. I mean, imagine in, like, Spirited Away, I can't think of the character's name, where the boy turns into a dragon is flying across the water. I mean, just imagine if that was CGI. It would take away from the beauty of it, you know?
Yeah, it really would. I mean, it works for Dragon Ball Z movies, but right. it wouldn't work here. Not for something that's supposed to be more, you know, art, you know, more kind of like the emotional aspect. I think maybe you generate that a little bit better to what Miyazaki's trying to accomplish with the hand-drawn style.
Yeah,
I don't really like Christian Bale. He wanted so bad to be a part of this film that he was just like, I don't care what role you give me. You know, I just want to be in it. And, you know, they gave him the lead.
Yeah. Yeah. And he's really, he plays his voice work on Hal is almost, it's low key Christian Bale. He's not doing Batman or this dark voice. He plays Hal with this calming effect. There's this boy who has power and can use it to do amazing things, but he plays Hal with this level of calmness throughout the whole thing, which despite this ordeal he's going through, being caught up in this war, trying to keep his castle going, trying to save Sophie and keep people alive, like you never see Hal ever get angry, ever get out of control. And I think Bale did that on purpose. They wanted Hal to be level throughout this whole thing. It's more Sophie is a little bit chaotic because she's trying to figure out everything that's going on and how to save how to save the castle. She's all over the place, but Hal is calm, cool, and collected throughout the entire film, you know, and it's awesome. But definitely a good film.
It was a nominee for best animated feature in the 06 Academy Awards. So he was, you know, chasing it again right after Spirited Away. So even though he wasn't trying to make a huge impact in America, I mean, he was still, you know, he was still gonna get an Academy Award potentially for this film.
But good stuff, man. If you've never seen his films, a lot of them are available on HBO Max or Max or whatever it's called now.
Yeah, now it's just Max.
You'll do yourself a favor to sit down and watch a Studio Ghibli or Miyazaki film. If you want to start off light, watch Ponyo, something real light, kind of very, very friendly. And work your way up, you know, maybe Spirited Away, Howl's Moving Castle, and Prince of Mononoke are a little bit deeper, a little heavier. You know?
Yeah.
But good films, all of them.
Nausicaa.
I still need to see The Wind Rises, his 2017 film. I haven't seen that yet. I need to watch it.
I haven't seen that either. I wonder if it's on Max.
Yeah. But, all right. Well, good stuff, man. We're doing this week, this month in pop culture history today. We're doing a little bit earlier in the month instead of the middle of the month because we've got something else planned for our back to school special next week. So, Matt, what you got for us this month in pop culture history?
Yeah, man. This month, pop culture history, 24 years ago, 1999, The Sixth Sense, starring Bruce Willis, Toni Collette, and Haley Joel Osment premieres. And that's the first film where, you know, he was a real workaholic in that film because he died and he still showed up for work. So that's dedication, man. He's still working. He's dead. And he's like, well, still got to show up. You know, got a kid. He needs my help.
You know that I've said this before on the podcast. You know, I've only watched that movie like twice, and I've always thought it was okay. I never got the real huge deal of it. I prefer Signs when it comes to Shyamalan's film. I really like Signs a lot.
Yeah.
But Sixth Sense is good.
I like the big reveal at the end. Yeah. It's, you know, where he finds that you realize he's dead. And then it just the whole time, you know, he's dead. And I just like that chilling factor you get whenever, you know, his mom doesn't believe him.
Yeah.
And then he's like, you know, he tells her, he gives a message to his mom about his grandmother. He's like, you asked her, you know, you asked her a question on her grave. After she died, and her answer is all the time. He's like, what did you ask her? And she's like, I asked if I made her proud. And I was like, man, I was like, but going on, you know, can't go on about Bruce Willis, even though he's great. 1940, this month in pop culture history, in 1940, German occupiers in France imposed censorship on rolls of film, requiring approval prior to exhibition and forbidding depiction of German losses in World War I. So they're pretty, they did not want themselves misrepresented.
And there's still countries that do that, like China. Still censors things in their films, bad talking to China, certain things. You know, 70 years later, we still have countries that censor films.
Yeah, man. They're like, hey, man, watch what you say about me. 2015, this month, pop culture history, Muppets, Miss Piggy, and Kermit the Frog announced to end their relationship on Twitter. I thought that was really weird. Didn't realize it even happened. And, you know,
yeah, I don't even
know. It's worth saying.
I don't even know what to say about that. Poor Kermit. I mean, or maybe, yeah. maybe Kermit's better off because, I mean, Miss Piggy would be kind of a bitch, man.
Shit, yeah. I think so, man. Kermit, he seems like a chill guy. I mean,
she's always
Miss
fucking
Piggy.
Screaming about shit. Oh, my, here we go, cussing at the end of the show. Yeah. Always screaming about crap in the movies and always yelling at Kermit. So, man, maybe Kermit, maybe my boy better off without her, you know?
Yeah, I think so, man. You know, have some time to hang out with the boys, man. Yeah,
had time to make sipping on some tea memes and stuff. You know?
1991, this month. Pop culture history. Actor Gary Oldman is arrested for drunk driving. I know you say that's a long time ago. I guess you could say that story is old, man. No?
Wow. Wow.
Yeah.
Derailed the show.
Derailed it with the dad joke. I didn't realize that happened, but it's like, oh.
Lots of actors have been arrested.
He's Gary Oldman, man. Yeah. 2006, this month, actor Sylvester Stallone and former heavyweight champion contender Chuck Wepner set a lawsuit in court for an undisclosed sum. Wepner claimed that he was the inspiration for the Rocky movies. I don't think that's true.
I remember that. I thought he was discredited after a while.
Yeah.
I know that I remember the lawsuit happened, but I think eventually he was discredited.
Yeah, I think he was. It was actually Rocky Marciano.
Yeah, and Sylvester had never even heard of the other guy, and I think it was discredited. One of those things where Sylvester had to give him some money to shut up. And, you
know. Yeah. I know our friend Carrie is a fan of the Beatles. This month, 1965, Beatles
the monkeys,
tape
man.
Appearance. Oh, yeah, it's the monkeys. Yeah. I'm sure he likes the Beatles, too, you know. Yeah, but they appeared on the Ed Sullivan Show. This is the famous Ed Sullivan Show appearance. You know, 65, man, 1965.
You know, Beatles. I never was a Beatles guy, but I'm not going to knock them like I do the Eagles. I still think the Eagles suck, but the Beatles, you know, Beatles were fine for their time. You know,
the Eagles get no love from you.
Yeah, no, Eagles are boring as fucking man.
So we were talking about the DC universe earlier. And I guess it's worth mentioning Jason Momoa is 44 years old this month.
That's it? For somebody I thought 44. He was maybe a little closer to 50. Dude's a man, I tell you what, Momoa's a badass.
He is, man.
Give him some credit, man. He's a badass. You know. That's all
1907. Oh yeah, sorry. That's all you gotta say. He's a badass. 1907, Harry Houdini. Escapes from chains underwater in 57 seconds at aquatic park in San Francisco, California. The great Houdini.
That dude was something, man. Yeah, I mean, you know, a lot of people to this day, people speak of discredit. People have tried to discredit him over the years, believe it was all not real, it was all staged. But how do you prove something back then before you had cameras and things like that? You know, you had eyewitnesses, and eyewitnesses said they saw it and it happened. So, you know, guess you got to believe it.
Can't argue with eyewitness testimony.
That's it.
And, man, we were talking about this the other day, this month, 2018, A Star is Born, film remake directed and starring Bradley Cooper, Lady Gaga, premieres Venice Film Festival.
Very good film.
Very good film.
Very, I mean, well acted, good performances. I mean, I was never a Lady Gaga fan, so I saw that movie and was like, wow, she's legit. She's very good in the film. And Bradley's amazing in the movie.
Yeah, man. He sings pretty good. She wasn't going to let him get away without actually doing his own singing.
Have you seen the movie?
Yeah.
Yeah. And he modeled his voice a bit off of Eddie Vedder and his other voice off Sam Elliott. Then he found out that Sam Elliott was in the film. And he's like, whoa, wait, what?
Yeah.
And there's even an end joke in the movie that was done on purpose where Sam Elliott's having, you even stole my voice and all that. And that was written in the script. But even though it's a serious moment in the film, it was kind of a play on that.
Sam Elliott is trying to keep his ass alive.
Yeah, but a good movie. I mean, a sad movie, but a really good movie.
You know, yeah.
Very well done.
That's about it, man. That's all I got for pop culture history.
Good shit, man. Good stuff, sorry. So yeah. Let's preview next week's episode. It's next week's episode is our big back to school special, and I promise next week's episode I'm going to watch my mouth. I promise, because we are going to go back to school next week. We're going to talk a really fun movie, and we're going to talk about what cartoons we would want on a Saturday morning next week, and what kind of cereal we're going to eat. We're going to go back to school with you next week and talk about our old school Saturday morning cartoons. And the movie we're going to discuss is the Lego Batman movie.
Must be great to be Batman.
Batman, we love you!
Thank you. I'm blushing super hard under the mask.
Batman!
Pray God.
Thanks, Batman!
Yeah. I can only imagine he's going home right now to party the night away, surrounded by friends and lady activewear models.
Hey, computer. I'm home. I'm home.
One is the loneliest number that you ever.
Master Bruce, your greatest fear is...
Snakes?
No.
Clowns?
No. It's being a part of a family again.
No, now it's snake clowns because you put that idea in my head.
Sir, you need to take responsibility for your life, and it starts by raising the young orphan you adopted.
I thought I was being sarcastic.
Hello, secret camera.
We built this city.
What? It's the Bat Cave! Oh my gosh, look, it's the Bat Sub!
Don't touch that.
The Bat Zeppelin!
Don't touch that either.
It's the Bat Kayak! No. Do I get a costume? I love it, but his pants are just a little tight. I got an idea. It's better.
I can only look you in the eyes right now.
Hi, Batman!
No way!
Come catch your greatest enemy.
Superman is my greatest enemy.
Superman's not a bad guy!
Then I'd say that I don't currently have a bad guy. I am fighting a few different people. I like to fight around.
Hi, Barbara Gordon, new police commissioner.
It's my dream for the police force to team up with Batman.
What?
Wouldn't that be better?
I hate everything you just said.
I'm falling!
Gotcha.
Nice.
Initialized master build.
Got it.
Here you go, Barbara.
I need an elbow. I need the macaroni. Yes, we did it. Pretty cool, huh?
Why did you build this thing with only one sheet?
Because last I checked, I only had one butt. Let's go defeat the Joker.
Woo! We're going on a family trip. I can wear my costume, too.
Well, luckily for us, you left your costume back. Oh, nope. Under your clothes. That's perfect.
Yes.
And yes, we do our annual Christmas Batman movie, but that's okay. Sometimes we sprinkle Batman movies throughout the year because there's been a lot of them. And this is a really fun movie. I really like the Lego Batman movie a lot. Enjoy the heck out of it. I like the Lego movie too, but I'm a Batman fan, so I like the Lego Batman movie a little bit more.
Yeah.
To be fair. So we're going to discuss that next week. Good fun movie. Easy to watch. It's available on Max to watch, I believe. And might be on a couple other streaming services, but the Lego Batman movie on next week's show for our first ever back to school special episode next week. We've never done this before. So we're we're going to have some fun next week. And a really quick tease, Matt, if you could pick just one cartoon you could watch every Saturday morning, what would it be?
Ooh, it would have to be, I'd say, Spider-Man.
All right, fair enough. I would probably say Batman the Animated Series, since we're doing the Lego Batman movie. But next week, we reveal our five cartoons we would watch on Saturday morning and our favorite cereals and other back-to-school rituals on next week's show. But until then, the RebelRadioPodcast.com for all your Rebel Radio needs. Follow us on all the different apps to listen to the show and Twitter and our Facebook group and all that good stuff. But to continue to be safe, and we thank you as always for listening. Until next time, this has been Mark.
This has been Matt.
Remember, as always, just go there
and do it.